I'm Rick Dalton. It's my pleasure, Mr. Schwartz.
Call me Marvin. Put it there. That's your son?
No, it's my stunt double, Cliff Booth.
Last night, we watched a Rick Dalton double feature. All the shooting. I love that stuff, you know, with the killing.
A lot of killing.
Anybody order fried sauerkraut?
No, I'm a stuntman.
Look at me.
So you're still with Rick, huh?
Still here.
You can do anything you want to him.
I hired you to be an actor, Rick. Not a TV cowboy. You're better than that.
Line.
Cut! Embarrass yourself like that in front of all those goddamn people.
All right, what's the matter, partner?
It's official, old buddy. Well, it has been.
An August night and the leaves hanging down and the grass on the ground.
Here I am, flat on my ass. And who I got living next door to me?
I'm Sharon Tate. I'm in the movie.
You're in this?
That's me. I play Miss Carlson, the Klutz.
It's a ragged tent.
Charlie's gonna dig you.
And that gospel group telling you and me this. Father loves it, father loves travel and salvation show. Hook up the babies and grab the old ladies and everyone goes. I say love, father loves.
In this town, that can all change like that.
Hey! You're Rick fucking Dalton. Don't you forget it.
Ba 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 ba. This is your seven. That's right, your seven. This is your seven of Movie Month. For 30 days, I'll watch 30 movies and do 30 podcasts. And this is day six.
Gentlemen, you're listening to The Real Don Steele.
KHJ Los Angeles.
An August night and the leaves hanging down and the grass on the ground smelling sweet.
Coming to you from the jungles of Massachusetts. Welcome back, everybody, to day sixth of Movie Month, where today I watched the Quentin Tarantino award-winning film Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. Folks, if you thought that you were going to see a historically factually accurate film story, Quentin Tarantino warned you. He warned you right in the title, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. What does Once Upon a Time invoke? It invokes the feeling of a fairy tale, of a story, of a tale based on things that didn't necessarily happen. And not only did this story not quite happen, it actually changed history, which he has done in the past. You remember when they burned Hitler down in Inglourious Basterds? That included Brad Pitt too. Brad Pitt enjoys to be part of Quentin Tarantino's historic alternate history kind of stories. And that's what this is. And you know, it really isn't, there goes the air conditioner again, it really isn't a story about the Manson family. You know, you think, oh, Quentin Tarantino's doing a Manson film. Not at all. You see Charles Manson in this movie for 5 seconds. I don't know, 10 seconds maybe. You do get some of the characters from the real historical Manson family. I recognize like Tex, and I recognize the name Squeaky Fromm, and really I recognize Tex because of Mindhunter on Netflix, which if you didn't realize, the Charles Manson from Mindhunter and the Charles Manson from Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, same actor, filmed around the same time, both the same actor, an Australian fella who I knew first as Dewey Crow from Justified, which also stars Timothy Olyphant, which brings us back to Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. Yes, this is one of those movies where I was told constantly by multiple people, one of which is listening, how great this movie is, and I can't believe I'm waiting, and I can't believe you haven't seen this movie yet. And I pushed myself. I waited. It was, on demand. I should rent it. Boom, bang, boom. Nope. I held off because I wanted it to be part of this year's movie month, and I'm glad I did because I loved this movie. It was fun. It was tense. It was disturbing at some points, but it was really mostly fun. I enjoyed the hell out of this movie, and it was because of Leonardo DiCaprio. His character was like so enjoyable with the ups and the downs. Like he was never fully like like garbage or like you hated him. It was almost like you felt sorry for him, and you saw this guy who is, you know, a slice of Hollywood. He's like an amalgamation of Hollywood actors in that era where they're, you know, or maybe in every era, where they're just looking to hit it big. They're looking to have good work. They're looking to be seen and noticed for that next job. And really, they're looking to be accepted. And that's what it seemed like with Leo, where he... You know, he was a young guy who did TV westerns, and then he's kind of washed up and he's become sort of a TV guest star now. And Al Pacino plays this guy, Schwartz, who is like an agent, I guess, or a casting director, I don't know. But he's helping Leo, and he's like, look, you talk about, you get beat up in a couple TV shows, all of a sudden you're the guy who gets beat up, and you don't look like you're a person who can win fights. And that's what the TV... That's what the public sees. And that's like, you know, what is it? Perception is reality. That's why you see, like, in the 80s, you never see, like, Arnold get his ass kicked in movies, really. I don't think Steven Seagal's ever been punched. I mean, he can barely lift his leg to do a kick. But, you know, it's these things where there's this machismo that some of these actors have. And it was kind of explained in that line, like, look, if you're getting beat up and people are used to seeing you beat up, you're never going to become that leading man again. And then he tells Tarantino, you know, you could go to Italy and make those, they're making westerns out there. And then I thought, is any of this based on Clint Eastwood? Because Clint Eastwood did do like early television. Then he went over to Italy to do the Sergio Leone movies, the spaghetti westerns. Then is when he came back and hit it big in the States. I think I could be wrong, but I think that's the how it happened, as far as, you know, that's about the only comparison I have. But maybe it's just showing, look, this is what people did in those days. This is how these movies, because wasn't even Django, wasn't Django, the original Django, like Italian, an Italian fella and Italian movies? I could be wrong, but Tarantino loves those old Western movies, and you know he definitely is inspired by them, and he's got to do them in Django Unchained, but he got to have fun with the Western TV and the tropes and shoot those. He got to shoot TV shows, old Westerns, in his movie. He got to shoot old movies in his movie, so it was probably awesome for him to be able to kind of, you know, do all these different genres in his own movie. He did an old, episode of a show called FBI. And I don't even know if that's a real show. I was talking back and forth with a guy, and he's like, you know, it's not like there's an intricate plot. I'm like, it really isn't. The plot's very straightforward, but it really is just the vibe that I got out of just how amazing they made everything look, and the performances, mostly by Brad Pitt, and Leo. Brad Pitt won the Oscar for it, and he deservedly so. And Leo, I thought, I mean, I know they gave the Oscar to Joaquin, and he was excellent, but Leo's right there. And I said, if Leo's not the GOAT, he's up there. He's close. He can play the suave, handsome guy. You know, they show him go-go dancing and certain things. Then they show him dressed up as a cowboy. And just the thought of this small girl telling him that it was some of the greatest acting he's ever seen, it meant so much to him because he has either such an ego or such a lack of self-confidence that he needs to be accepted. And he almost started crying. He did start crying from that. I don't know. He was so great in this movie. And so was Brad Pitt. Like, they did give you the kind of overarching, you know, I do love when you see like a fictional story told within the confines of something historical happening. You know, Mad Men did that a lot with certain things happening while big major historical things were happening in the background in the rest of the world. And they kind of did that here, but then they didn't really do it because it wasn't like it was, you know, I'm thinking this is all leading up to the Manson killings, Sharon Tate and the other guys. Like when I heard the names, I said, uh-oh, I think I know why those names are familiar. Uh-oh, four people. Those are the people. And then at a certain point in the movie, we get to like Kurt Russell doing voiceover. Kurt Russell plays a stuntman in this. And then also he's doing voiceover at one point. So I'm thinking, is he telling the tale to somebody about this? But he starts talking about this specific day and going by time, where Sharon Tate was here, where she went there, where meanwhile, Cliff and Rick are off doing this. And you're like, oh boy, this is all going to end with the Manson family showing up. And the Manson family does show up. There's four of them there. Three of them end up, you know, Rick ends up yelling at them to leave. They leave. And I'm thinking, well, that's weird. Is something else going to happen? Then they start coming back. I'm like, okay. But they don't. This is where Tarantino, I mean, spoiler alert if you haven't seen this, Tarantino changes history. Once again, the Manson family does not kill Sharon Tate, pregnant Sharon Tate, does not kill the other people in the house, doesn't kill anybody. They break into Rick's house, and Brad Pitt basically, you know, while he's, you know, tripping on an acid dipped cigarette, he beats the crap out of all of them, you know, takes out the guy who had the gun, has his dog help, gets them all, ends up just, you know, I think obviously because he's high on acid, he smashes this girl's face to death. The other guy, the dog beats to the point where I think then he starts kicking his face in, he's dead. And then the third girl freaks out, gets in the pool. I thought, oh no, Leo's going to die. Just like almost every other movie Leo's in, he's going to die. And instead, Leo goes into his shed. And earlier in the movie, we see him doing some real B-grade action movie where, you know, he's got a flamethrower. Later on, we see Brad Pitt going to fix his antenna, Rick's antenna. And we see the flamethrower in the shed. So he actually kept the flamethrower from the movie. They probably paid him so little he got to keep the flamethrower. And it came back because in the end he goes and gets the flamethrower and torches this third person. And the movie ends with Leo becoming friends with Sharon Tate. And now he's got Hollywood friends. So you feel like his career is actually going to skyrocket from here because, A, he's made a couple of Italian movies and made some good money off that. But he's, you know, he told Brad Pitt, look, I don't think I can afford you anymore. You know, I got a wife now. But then B, he saves all these, he ends up saving people from this Manson family, taking these villains out. But then again, I don't know. Maybe the Manson family and all this doesn't become anything major because it just looks like these three junkies, these three hippie junkies, whatever, break into their house. Like maybe they never know the connection to Charles Manson, and either he does it again to somebody else or he never does it. He tried it once, it failed, and he never does it. These are all the things that are just kind of left open with what would happen if they didn't get away with it. And I had no idea this was going to happen. Like up until, you know, I look at this like, well, there's only 10 minutes left. oh, they're Brad Pitt. Oh, wait, that guy, the dog. Well, then they're going to leave and go next. Nope, he's dead. Oh, nope, she's definitely dead. And that woman is burnt to a crisp. And, you know, it was like, well, what was the movie about? Well, really, it was about an actor who was coming to terms with the fact that he wasn't what he used to be. Meanwhile, he's got a quote-unquote stunt double who has done stunts for him in the past, but basically he's like his paid friend and his gopher, his everything, because it's like paying for a companion, basically. That's what everything Brad Pitt is. And it's kind of there dealing with the changing tides of getting older in Hollywood, and at the same time coming across with these, you know, this hippie commune cult that actually Leo Rick didn't know anything about. Brad Pitt kind of got pulled into it when he went off to, he picked up one of the hippie girls, took her back to where she was living. He's like, oh, I used to do films at this ranch. It was called, I can't remember it, but it was a film ranch. And he's like, I used to do films at this ranch. And I looked it up. That was a real place where I think that's where they lived. I didn't want to read too much because I was still watching the movie. But Brad Pitt's like, or I should call him Cliff Booth. He's like, I used to do movies here with Gus, the guy who owned it. I think his name was Gus. We'll go with that. And or George. He's like, oh, is he here? Like, no, he's napping. And you get this vibe that they killed this guy and are, you know, just living there in his place, because they're kind of all hippies, all dirty and living in squalor. And Brad Pitt, for some reason, he's got the balls to be like, I don't know, what's, you know, I'm going to go check on him. And that's where we saw Elle Fanning was playing Squeaky Frome, right? And turns out that they were telling the truth. The guy was alive. It was Bruce Dern played this guy, who's basically, you know, pretty much blind, old, and he just gets to hang out with these young people, which they're probably taking advantage of him. But, you know, Brad Pitt came across all these people, and then later on in the movie, they came back. Now, he walked right by them with his dog. They probably were so freaked about what they were about to do that they didn't even notice that that's the same old dude, or just these, you know, 50-year-old white guys all look the same. They walk by, these Hollywood types all look the same, and they walk by him and don't even think anything. That's when they go to kill everybody, or they're about to kill everybody, but then Rick Dalton's making margaritas scares them away, and then they come back. But then one of the girls, Maya Hawke, that's Ethan Hawke's daughter from Stranger Things, she freaks out and leaves just the three of them on their own. And a good thing she did, because she'd also be dead, I'm assuming, because Brad Pitt and Brad Pitt's dog, it's pretty awesome. Yet, they make you feel that Brad Pitt isn't what he claims to be, or isn't as likable. He seems fairly likable through this whole movie. Even an underage girl offers to do some sexual favors to him, and he's like, how old are you? I need to see some identification. Now, if she was proof that she was 18, I'm sure he would have taken her up on the offer. But he's like, I'm not going to jail for, he says something crude, I'm not going to say it, but I just thought that was, you know, so he's not a scumbag. Yet, there is rumors or factual or proof or something. What is going on? I think there's like a party next door. I think social distancing is over in parts of my neighborhood. So there is, like, we don't find out about this until, like, Quentin is working. No. So Cliff Booth, Brad Pitt, is working on an antenna in on Leo's house, right? And then we cut over and we see him on set. Now, I didn't realize until later. I thought, oh, he must have got him that job. But no, he was thinking back about Brad. Leo's like, I can't really get you a job here. The stunt guy is this guy, Rudy, and, you know, he has his guys. And he goes, oh, okay, I understand. And then while Brad Pitt is, you know, fixing the antenna, he has a flashback to the last time he worked with Rudy. And actually, it was the same thing where Leo had to try, had to beg, basically, to get him to work. He's like, you don't even have to give him work. Just get him in hair and makeup. If he can work, he work. If he can't, he can't. You don't have to pay him. Just give him something. That was Kurt Russell was like, yeah, you know why I don't want to do this. He's like, why? He goes, he killed his wife. And I was like, what? Where did that come from? And then he's like, he didn't. What are you talking about? That didn't happen. And then they show Brad Pitt on a boat with a woman who is completely treating him like yelling at him, calling him a loser, this, that. And Brad Pitt's putting on a mask, and he's got a spear gun, and the spear gun is aimed right at the woman. And I'm like about to cover my eyes thinking, here it comes, here it comes, here it comes. We never see it. So we don't know. We have no idea. Now, this is a flashback within a flashback, right? So Brad Pitt is... Maybe he could hear them in the wagon that they were in the trailer. He could hear the conversation. So that's how we can be part of that conversation too in the flashback. I don't know. It doesn't matter. But the thing is Brad Pitt possibly killed his wife, and it's known enough that people in Hollywood know. So Brad Pitt does end up getting a job because Leo's like, he served in the war. He's a war hero, and I think that got to Kurt Russell. I'm using all the actor names. And so we got a job for Brad Pitt. So he's just waiting around on set. And it turns out this was an episode of The Green Hornet. Now, The Green Hornet is an old serial, old comic book that then they made a TV show in the 60s, which was a spinoff of the old Batman and Robin TV show. I think it was a spinoff of that. And in the comics, in the movie. Now, there's a movie years later with Seth Rogen that did nothing. But in all of this, he has a Chinese butler, right? Chinese? He has an Asian butler. I don't want to say the wrong. Bruce Lee's Chinese, right? Yeah. Butler named Kato, and he's played by the Bruce Lee. There's even an episode of Batman and Robin where Bruce Lee is in it. And so Bruce Lee, it looks like they're just hanging around on set. You got Brad Pitt just sitting there in a tux, and Bruce Lee kind of talking smack about how he could do this, he could do that, and how he could, he could beat up Ali. And Brad Pitt calls him on it, and he's like, no, these, he's like, well, I could, but it would never happen. My hands are lethal weapons. If I kill a man, I'll go to jail. And Cliff Booth, Brad Pitt's like, if anybody kills somebody with their bare hands, they're going to jail. It's called manslaughter. And then they end up fighting, and Bruce, he's like, friendly combat to see who can better who. 2 out of 3. Bruce Lee ends up getting one. Brad Pitt ends up getting the second one, smashing him into a door, into a car. And then the third time, they're kind of doing all these, karate like moves together. Brad Pitt's keeping up with Bruce Lee. And then the woman who's producing it, I think, she was, or she's just the set manager. I don't know what she was doing, but she's Kurt Russell's wife. She's like, what the F is going on here? What is this? That's our star. You're beating up with our star. That's my effing car. And she's like, get the F out of here. And Kurt's like, I'll handle it. He's like, listen, you got to get the F out of here. So I think, and then we show Brad Pitt like, yeah, that makes sense. That's why I couldn't work on this Western with you. At that fight, one of the guys goes, you know who that is? That's Cliff Booth. He tells the Bruce Lee, he's like, he killed his wife. He got away with killing his wife. He's like, he did? So that was just a cool moment. And the guy I was texting with said, and it's Brad Pitt, thinking about this. Is it the unreliable narrator where this is the memory of that Brad Pitt's having? Like that he actually bested Bruce Lee and could keep up with him. So I was like, I didn't even think of that. It's another cool thing. Because he himself sees himself as like, this kind of like guy that can do it all. I do like that he took his wig off because his hair looked ridiculous. He took his wig off before going to go have the fight. One of my favorite Leo scenes in the movie is when he is on set for a Western. Now, in the Western, we see Timothy Oliphant. We see him as himself for a bit, but for the most part, he's playing the actor in the movie. Luke Perry, RIP, really, we just see him playing an actor in this movie, this TV show, where Rick is the bad guy. He's the Western bad guy. This is his job now. He plays the bad guy. But one of my favorite scenes is just him and a little girl. And I want to go back and watch it again, because at one point I'm thinking they haven't cut in a while and they're just going. And he's kind of explaining this book she's reading, that he's reading, and about a guy who comes to terms with the fact that he's not as good as he once was. And he starts crying because it reminds him of her. And the little girl comes over and comforts him. He's like, don't, she's got like this, like a great little actor, not actress, because she does not subscribe to the term actress, because it doesn't even make sense. She's a good little actor. And she is like, she seemed more of the adult than Rick Dalton did. And I thought that was cool too. I enjoyed that. I loved that scene. And then later when they're in a scene together, she leans over to him and she's like, that was some of the best acting I've ever seen in my life. And she's like 8 years old. And the look of like pride that was on Leo's face was amazing. Like, oh my God, I did it. I'm Rick effing Dalton. I did it. I impressed this 8-year-old girl. I loved that scene. It was just little things like that that weren't major parts of the movie. It just built characters. This was like a character study of different actors. And I haven't even mentioned Margot Robbie, Sharon Tate. She played Sharon Tate in this movie. Now, she's married to Roman Polanski in this movie. We kind of get a little narrative from one of the guys. I can't remember the guy's name. He was on Homeland. He's been in a bunch of different things. He's on Billions now. I think he's Steve McQueen in this movie. They're at the Playboy Mansion, and he's like, she used to be with him, and then she went off and did a movie with Roman Polanski, and then she married him, but now they're all friends and hanging out. And, you know, Roman Polanski is a famous director, famous for Rosemary's Baby. The last movie that I can think of that he did is The Piano. He's famous for being married to Sharon Tate at the time of Sharon Tate's murder. Now, at the same time, I believe he was also... No. Okay. For some reason, I thought had something to do with Natalie Wood, but no. At the same time, Roman Polanski, to me, is now known as the dude who possibly raped or sexually assaulted a 13-year-old girl and is now living overseas and can't get back to the United States without getting arrested, right? Am I correct in that? He is basically what I would determine as a scumbag. Now, maybe he wasn't then. I don't know. Back then, he's just a guy who looks like he dressed like Austin Powers, drove fancy cars, and was married to an up-and-coming starlet, Sharon Tate. Now, it was cool to see, how Quentin Tarantino did the Sharon Tate thing. So I have no idea of any factual idea of this at all. But again, it's Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, so it doesn't have to be factual. Where Sharon Tate is in Hollywood on the set, goes and sees a theater playing one of her movies starring Dean Martin. And she's like, oh my God, I'm on the poster. Oh, like she sees her name and she sees on the poster and she's all excited. And she's like, how much to see this movie? And they're like, 50 cents. She's like, oh, what if I'm in the movie? So apparently this actress doesn't even have 50 cents. Was it in 50 cents or something crazy like that? She's like, what do you mean, what if you're in the movie? She goes, I'm in the movie. I'm Sharon Tate. That's you. And they point to the poster. And she goes, that's me. And they get either the manager or the usher. He's like, oh, Miss Tate, of course. Would you like to come see the movie? By all means, come and see the movie. Now, in the photos, I believe that was the real Sharon Tate in the photos. Because also, in the movie, they do put Margot Robbie in it, right? Like at some points. But then at some points, it's definitely the real Sharon Tate that they have acting. Like it really is her. They didn't switch it. They didn't do anything digitally. It's just Sharon Tate. And they look so close in reality that it's like you don't even really notice it. You could be like, oh, wow, that she looks different in the movie. Well, it's because it's not actually Margot Robbie, right? But then they do intersperse it with Margot Robbie training for a fight with Bruce Lee. And it's just, it was well done. And again, she was kind of not as desperate as Rick Dalton, because she's up and coming, but she was like in the theater, and when people reacted and laughed at a certain scene that she was trying to get laughs in, the look of joy on her face, she was beaming with pride. And then at the same time, they started to cheer when she beat up the bad guy, the bad girl in the movie. And again, the look of joy on her face, like, yeah, yeah, you know, like they clapped, and she, you could feel like she felt like she has achieved something. And she's like, you know, probably felt like I can really do this. There was no interaction with her and Rick and Cliff until the exact last scene. Even then was a little tense. I was like, is something weird going to happen here? But no, it was just Brad Pitt left, taken off on an ambulance, and Rick Dalton, Leo, kind of left behind. And then the neighbor, one of the guys who was living with Sharon Tate at the time, starts talking to Leo, and they end up kind of saying, come on up for a drink. And he's like, yeah, sure. And they become friends. And I think that's what I mentioned that already, but I just wanted to mention that again. I'm going inside because it's going to start raining soon. Geez. I know there's so much I haven't talked about yet. So much I've left off the out of the podcast so far. But, I mean, just the little details, like all the things they did when they were showing Rick acting, as far as, you know, he was in an episode of this, or the posters that he was, these movie posters he was in. The fact where he is envisioning how good he would have been if he was in The Great Escape instead of Steve McQueen. Because one of the, I think it was Timothy Olyphant, the character, the actor, was saying, weren't you almost in The Great Escape? And he's like, well, I wouldn't classify it as almost, you know, as you would. He goes, I didn't read for anybody, I didn't talk to anybody, I wasn't offered anything. But the rumor is if Steve McQueen didn't take it, then, you know, I would have been up for it. But while they were doing that, we were seeing scenes of the actual Great Escape with Leo in the role. And to me, I was like, well, wait, is he lying? Did they actually, first I'm thinking they shot it and scrapped it with him, but it's really just him envisioning how great he would have been in it. And then later on, they talked about Leo goes to Italy and he's like, he gained 15 pounds. And you could see that just Leo bulked up a bit. Like you could just tell that, like, he's wearing a tight shirt at one point. He just looked a little different. His hair was long. He wasn't a hippie, but he was definitely getting that 60s vibe, almost 70. I mean, this movie was 2 hours and 40 minutes, and it's not even close to me doing it justice. Like, I feel like it is definitely one that I will watch again. This isn't even going to be the longest movie I watch this month. That is a fact. But this is definitely one I am going to watch again to just kind of catch it. I don't think I'm going to catch things I've missed as much as, well, maybe the little details in the background. I mean, just the costume design and the set design was so great in this. It didn't feel like we were looking at any CGI stuff. So maybe all of it was real, all of it was practical. And if it wasn't, it was so well done that it was subtle enough you wouldn't even notice. But so many little things, like I loved seeing the Mad magazines and knowing that they got the Mad magazine artist to do these. I loved, again, the posters. And then I loved the commercial at the end. Now, if you stay for the credits, you're going to see a commercial for Red Apple cigarettes that Leo does. And he actually, then it cuts and he gets all angry and pissy. And you realize when he was a young actor, it shows him being this, like, what is this? What is that? I got a double chin in this photo. This cigarette tastes like crap. And he's this big, jerk. And then later on, he's playing the bad guy in this Western TV show. He makes a mistake. And instead of getting upset with him, he goes back to his cabin and gets upset with himself. So it's, you could see the ego was completely kind of sucked away from him. You know, it just juxtaposed from the young Rick to the older Rick. And also just seeing Red Apple cigarettes, which is a staple of Quentin Tarantino movies. I think all the way going back to Reservoir Dogs. They smoke a specific brand, Red Apple cigarettes. I don't even know what else to talk about. I think I've covered everything. Just again, The set design, as I said, the costumes, and the soundtrack was excellent. Just here in KHJ, Los Angeles, where I've heard that before. That's like a very famous jingle of you know, a very famous radio station in LA. All of it put together just created a perfect fairy tale, a modern style fairy tale. A modern style. When I say fairy tale, it's not like there was a, well, I guess there was a happy ending. Really, there was. When you think about it, the bad guys were thwarted and the good guys, quote unquote, won. But again, I'm into historical altering, you know, alternative history, kind of things like that, where they take what you think, what you know, and twist it. And it's like, well, what if? And Quentin does a great job at that. He always, every movie you go in, you know you're going to get some quality, A quality dialogue, and quality visual, quality character, just everything. And when you have a long movie like this, you have the ability to take time to do things that build characters. It's not just action, 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 plot, 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 plot. It is just fine-tuning things and creating characters based on the dialogue. That is why Quentin Tarantino is so great, and that is why this movie was so excellent. Yes. And I think I'm done. So, and I'm sure I've missed a ton. I'm sure I have. But if you want to yell at me and complain to me about it, do me a favor. Find me on Twitter at Geek Mentality. You can tweet to me at your heart's content. You can also find me on Instagram, also at Geek Mentality. The website is fansnotexperts.com, and the Facebook page is also fansnotexperts. That is really it. Here we are. It is Saturday, and there are 7 days in a week. It was about maybe 10:30 this morning. I realized it wasn't Sunday. It's Saturday. I'm on 4-day weekends, so it is absolutely like these days. It's bad enough when you're stuck at home already, but then you take days off, and you really it throws you off a little bit. Now, yesterday I mentioned my dog had a tick on her. She's fine. Don't worry about it. I also mentioned that I had to build my wife's bike. I did that. And she got on it and she rode about 10 feet, hit a curb, fell, scraped her elbow. Literally 2 minutes into having the bike. I think the bike might be too big. So because it fits me fine, but it is like she's on her tippy tails just trying to get on the seat. So we screwed that up. That's what happens when you buy a bike sight unseen on Amazon. But she's fine. The bike is nice, but we might end up getting, being my bike. So pretty cool. Yeah, that's it. Tomorrow, I got this on Stars again. This was part of that free week of Stars. And there's two other movies that I want to watch on Stars. So I'm definitely going to watch one of those tomorrow. And I might watch the next one, on Monday. We shall see. But until tomorrow, my friends, thanks for listening. Thank you for subscribing. I hope you watch this movie. I hope you watch all the movies, and I hope to see you again tomorrow. But until then, here is my theme song.
This is my podcast. I made it. Geek Mentality is what I named it. And I think you should listen and subscribe. 'Cause I'm kind of funny and awesome. I think that I'm worth your time, and I'm kind of handsome. My mom says, please listen and please subscribe. At least listen to this episode.
Fans Not Experts.